Hey man, we're in a series right now on our discipleship track. It's a 17-week long discipleship track, a 17-week long process of taking someone from a conversation about what it means to follow Jesus, from taking someone who's not following Jesus into relationship with him, and then all the way through to giving them a firm foundation of theological belief, but also teaching them what it means to be a disciple who makes disciples. And so that's where we want everyone in our church to be. Discipleship track is fundamental. It's core to who we are, because we believe that the vision that God gave the church was to go and make disciples, and we don't believe that we should complicate it much more than that. If Jesus said, hey, I'm leaving, I'm going to leave you the Holy Spirit, and here's what I want you to do with the Holy Spirit, go and make disciples of all nations. Well, we don't have to complicate it a lot more, because that's a pretty tall order on its own. Go and make disciples of the entire world. And so we deeply believe, it is core to who we are, core to the DNA of Wellspring Church, that we are all disciples. We're on this lifelong journey of getting closer to Jesus. And really, to fully be a disciple and everything that that means, it means that we become disciple makers. So every single believer, not just the pastors, not just the staff, not just the deacons, not just the Sunday school teacher, but every believer is called to be a disciple, one, but also to be a disciple maker. And you're not fully a disciple until you are raising up another generation of disciples behind you. So that is the heart behind discipleship track. We've never done a series on Sunday that teaches all the way through discipleship track. And so that's what we started a couple weeks ago. The first step in discipleship track is believe. And that's just a conversation about following Jesus and what it means to follow Jesus. Then last week we talked about professing, and everything from the believe point on flows from that point. Everything from that point on is about following the example and the teaching and the commands of Jesus, who, once we believe on him, we've made the Lord, the ruler, the guide, the direction for our lives. And so from now on, we're just learning what it means to follow Jesus. So last week we talked about professing our faith in water baptism, and we follow Jesus' example because he did that. And so if we're going to follow him, then it's something that we should do as well. That brings us to our third step in the discipleship track process today, and that is connecting, following Jesus' example in connecting with community. So this third step in our journey to becoming more like Jesus is connecting with community. As we will discuss in this section, community is critical to the successful and healthy life of any follower of Jesus. Ecclesiastes 4:9-10 says, two are better than one because they have a good reward for their toil. They have a good reward for their work or for their labor. For if they fall, one will lift up his fellow. But woe to him who is alone when he falls and has not another to lift him up. And we're going to come back to that text at the end this morning. But let's talk about first, what do you need to know about connecting as it connecting to community as it relates to following the example of Jesus? And there are several things we're going to discuss this morning. The first one is this: God's original design was for community. If you go all the way back to Genesis and you read through the Old Testament, and then if you start in Matthew and you read through the New Testament, you will see that God's design for us, for humans, was that we live in community. Genesis chapter 1, the beginning, verse number 26 says, then God said, let us make man in our image after our likeness. Well, who, if nothing else existed, no other people existed, then who is the us, our, and our that God is talking about? We'll talk about it in a second. Go to Genesis 2, verse number 18. Then the Lord said, "It is not good that man should be alone. I will make him a helper fit for him." We'll talk more about the Trinity next month, but we can't talk about community and our need for community without recognizing that the very nature of God is community. The Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, they operate in such close community that they are one God. God himself is a community. It is in his nature. So since God operates in community, it's natural that he would want us, that he would want man, who was created in his image, to live in community as well. Genesis 2:18 says, it's the first recorded time where God ever looked at his creation and said, "That is not good." As God was creating the world and everything in it, he would always look on those things and say, "That's good." He created the birds and he said, "Hey, those are some good birds." He created the land and the water, day and night, sun in the sky, and he would step back and he would look at it and he would say, "Man, that's good." And the first time, guys, I don't think that we should take it personally, but the first time that God ever said something wasn't good was when he created us, and he stepped back and he looked and he goes, "That isn't a good thing." But it's not that his creation was bad. It's not that man was bad. But what he recognized was that man was alone. That there was nothing else like man to live in community with man. The first time that God ever says that something was not good was at the idea that man would be alone. And not just alone in the world, but alone in that no, because there were animals there. So he wasn't totally alone, but no one else, nothing else in the world at that point could connect with Adam like he needed to be connected with. That's why we celebrate marriage, because community is good, because a man and a woman have found each other and they've committed a lifelong community together. It's not just physical community that we need. It's not just physical community that we desire. It's community for our soul and our spirit. So without going too deep into Genesis here, when the Bible says that we're made in the image of God, it means that we are primarily created as a spirit. You are not, I know that this is hard for us to get our minds around because we live in a world that is dominated by the physical. What we see, what we touch, what we want, and everything around us is driven by the physical, but you are not primarily physical. The physical part of your body is going to die. Now, one day you're going to get a new and perfected body and everything's going to be great for eternity with Christ, but the part of you that will never die is your soul, is your spirit. That's the part. God is spirit. And so that's the part of us that's made in the image of God. It's not like God looks like us physically, like that's the image that he made. He made us spirit because he is spirit. And our souls, our spirit needs to exist in community. Our soul longs for community. And we can find that community for our spirit in so many ways. We find it, one way that we find it is in healthy marriages. One way that we find it is in healthy churches. We find it in brothers and sisters in Christ who we may not see every week, but still somehow we feel this deep connection to. Why? Because our spirits are united through Jesus Christ in community, and we need that. If God's nature is community and humans were created for community, then a natural part of becoming more like Jesus is that we intentionally connect with community. And that word intentionally there, it's not just a buzzword, it's not just a filler word. We're going to talk about it a little later on, but we have to be intentional about how we connect with the community. One, intentionally connecting, intentional to connect, but also being intentional about who we're connecting ourselves with. We'll talk about that again in a few minutes. Number two this morning is this: Jesus was connected to community. If we're talking about what it means to follow Jesus, what it means to imitate his life, we can see in Scripture that we'll read in just a moment that he was connected to community himself. Luke 6, verses 12 and 13 talk about this. In these days, he went out to the mountains, to the mountain to pray, and all night he continued in prayer to God. And when day came, he called his disciples and chose from them 12 whom he named apostles. So here, disciples is followers, people who are learning from him. And so Jesus' ministry has been launched at this point, and he goes up onto a mountain. He prays all night long. He talks to the Father all night long. And he comes down to a mass of disciples. He says he called his disciples to him. That's a large group of disciples there. It doesn't mean the 12, because the 12 haven't been chosen. That's what he's doing right here. He calls the disciples to him, and he chooses from them 12 whom he names apostles. So again, there's a large crowd of people following Jesus. Even so, we know that having a lot of people around doesn't necessarily mean that we have a lot of close relationships. Have you ever been completely surrounded by people, but still alone? One of the loneliest times of my life that I can remember, I was surrounded by hundreds of people a day, but I felt alone. We need more than just proximity. We need intimacy. See, you can come to church and you can have proximity to a lot of things. You can come to church and you can have proximity to the Spirit of God. But that's different than intimacy with the Spirit of God. You can come to church and stand by someone who worships. And so you're in proximity to the Spirit. You're in proximity to the presence of God. It's totally different than being in the presence of God. And that's what we need. Not just proximity with other people. We need intimacy. We need relationships with other people. We need that close group of friends with whom we deeply connect. Jesus was very intentional to choose 12 men. He went up and prayed about it all night long. When's the last time that you went anywhere? Jesus went, got away. He went up on a mountain, and the Bible says that he prayed all night long. When's the last time that you got alone with God and prayed all night long? It's not meant to be a point of conviction. I'm saying it because Jesus was incredibly intentional about the people who he surrounded himself with. It was important enough to him to skip an entire night's sleep to talk to the Father to make sure that the people he was about to invite into his circle were the right people for the time. He was very intentional about choosing who his friends would be, about choosing who his community would be. Luke chapter number 8, verse number 1, soon afterward, he went on through the cities and villages proclaiming and bringing the good news of the kingdom of God, and the 12 were with him. So he began journeying around. He began touring around doing ministry. And the Bible says the 12 whom he picked when he came off the mountain, the 12 were with him. Mark chapter number 4, 33 and 34. With many such parables, he spoke the word to them as they were able to hear it. He did not speak to them without a parable. This is talking about the masses. This is talking about the large groups. But privately to his own disciples, this is the 12. Privately to his own disciples, he explained everything. These men traveled with Jesus nonstop. When Jesus went to a village, they followed him. When Jesus got in a boat to cross the sea, they followed him. When Jesus stopped to eat, they did the same thing. This gave them an access to Jesus that the people in the crowds just did not have. Jesus opened up to his disciples in a special way. Why? Because they were his people. They were his community. Can we stop here and say that you can tell by looking around at our culture and our society today that too many people don't have this? That too many people don't have a real genuine community of people who they love and trust and confide in. They don't have a truly close group of friends that they can count on and that they can, again, confide in. And we know that because when they have something that they need to share, when something's going on in their life, they have no other place except for a social public outlet to vent their thoughts and their worries and their fears or even their celebrations. When we hurt, we don't tell Facebook because we have a community. So we go tell our community. When we celebrate, I don't tell Instagram that I'm celebrating. I tell my community. I tell the people that I'm actually connected and doing life with. And a lack of genuine community is why so many people take their problems and their praises to a public forum. We're as connected to the world as we have ever been. Right now, all of us in the room, we're as connected to the world as we have ever been, but we also have the least amount of community that we have ever had. It's a problem. We should be open. We should be vulnerable. We should share what we're going through. And I'm talking about the highs and I'm talking about the lows, but we should have a community of people who we do that with. Matthew 17, 1 and 2. It says, after 6 days, Jesus took with him Peter, James, and John, his brother, and led them up on a high mountain by themselves. And he was transfigured before them, and his face shone like the sun, and his clothes became as white as light. John 19, 26 and 27, when Jesus saw his mother and the disciple whom he loved, that's John. Anytime that you're reading in John, and it says the disciple whom he loved, John is talking about himself. He writes in his own book that he's the disciple that Jesus loved more than anyone else. And if you got the pen, then why not? That's if the Holy Spirit would have allowed it, I probably would have tried to write it that way. Jesus is on the cross here is what John's talking about. And he looks down at John, who was his best friend. The Holy Spirit let him write it, so it stands, the test of Scripture. He looks down at John, he looks down at his mother, and he says, "Woman, behold your son," and he said to the disciple, so he said to John, "Behold your mother," and from that hour the disciple, that's John, took her, Jesus' mother, into his home. He adopted her as his mother. It's worth noting that within the 12, Jesus had three men, Peter, James, and John, who were even closer than the others. These men had a relationship with Jesus that the other nine did not have. While the 12 all got special access to Jesus, and they all traveled with Jesus, and they all ministered with Jesus, and saw so many things, within the 12, there were three that were even closer. And then within the three, there was even one who was the best friend of Jesus, and that's John. This is not a promotion of excluding people. If you take what I'm saying and you twist it, you can make it seem like, well, then we should just get our community, we should get our small group, and we don't allow anybody else in, we don't allow anybody else around. It's just us, and that's what you're saying, that we should come and get this tight-knit community, and it should only be us. That's not at all what I'm saying. It's not a promotion of excluding people. However, it is a promotion of strategically choosing the people who will be in your inner circle, who will have the most access to your life, who you will allow to have the privilege of speaking into your life. And we've said it many times, but it bears repeating right here. Anyone can speak to you, but only a few people can speak into you. There's a difference. Any random person can walk by and say anything that they want to say. You get to choose if that person has access and influence and gets to speak into you, and there's a difference. So as a rule here, we are friendly to everyone. We are friends with many people, but it is good to have a small core of brothers and sisters who have the most access and who have the most influence in our lives. Number three this morning is this. So Jesus, God is community. His nature is community, so we should live in community. Jesus, number two, sets the example for us by surrounding himself with community. So if Jesus needed friends, if Jesus needed close spiritual community, then certainly we need community as well, right? The third thing is this, though, community, it's good for you. Community is good for you. You are better when you're in a healthy community. Ecclesiastes, our primary text for the day, Ecclesiastes 4, 9 and 10 says, two are better than one because they have a good reward for their toil. They have a good reward for their work. For if they fall, so if one of them falls over, one will lift up his fellow. But woe to him who is alone when he falls and has not another to lift him up. Whenever I read that scripture, I think about that old commercial. It was probably kind of some kind of Lifeline commercial. But all that I can see when I read that scripture is a grandma laying on her back in the bathtub going, help, I've fallen and I can't get up. Woe to grandma when she falls in the bathtub and no one is there to help lift her up. And it's funny until you're the grandma that falls in the bathtub. Wasn't in my notes, but it needed to be said. Ecclesiastes 4:12. Though a man might prevail against one who is alone, two can withstand him. It means that you shouldn't be fighting your fights alone. And I'm not talking about physical fights. I'm talking about spiritual ones. A threefold cord is not quickly broken. That's how Ecclesiastes 4:12 ends. A man might prevail against one who is alone. Two will withstand him. A threefold cord is not quickly broken. Community benefits you in so many different ways. The Bible reminds us here that it's not good to try to walk through the failures of life alone. The only way that we can have access through failure is if we're doing life in community, and there's someone there that can come along beside us and help raise us up and help lift us up. When we're intentional in community and we fall, someone is there to help us up and to move forward. And what the Bible is saying is, woe to the man, woe to the person who falls, who has a stumble, who has a failure, and who has no community to help them up out of that failure and give them a way forward. Community benefits us in so many ways. Not only are the failures of life made easier by community, but the victories of life are sweeter when we enjoy them together, when we enjoy them with community. Danik and I have been here long enough now that we have both cried and celebrated with many of you. We've mourned the loss of loved ones, and we've celebrated marriages and births with the same people. And what I was reminded of as I was going through this message for this morning is that we are all better off because we're together. That I'm better because you're in my life. That we're all better, that everything is better when we're together. Everything is better in teams. So not only is the community good for you, it's easy for us to hear that one, right? Because it's something that's good for us, and we like things that are good for us. The next thing, though, is not only is the community good for you, but number four, you are good for the community. So not only do you need others to live your best, most fulfilled life, but others need you to be investing in them so that they can live their best, most fulfilled life. Proverbs 27, verse number 17 says, iron sharpens iron, so one man sharpens another. 2 Timothy 3, 10 and 11 says, you, however, have followed my teaching. This is Paul writing to his spiritual son, Timothy. You followed my teaching, my conduct, my aim in life, my faith, my patience, my love, my steadfastness, my persecutions and sufferings that happened to me at Antioch and Iconium and Lystra, which persecutions I endured, yet from all of them the Lord rescued me. Paul's writing to Timothy, and what he's saying here is, hey, you have watched me live my life. Paul has invested into Timothy, and Timothy's better off for it because he had someone who was pouring into him. So we all certainly are made better by community, but the community's also made better when we're there. The community's also made better when we invest in it. When we're new in our faith, it's easy for us to understand the need for community. It's easy for us to understand the need of someone to pour into us. We quickly understand the need for someone to walk with us and to help us learn and walk through real life situations and help us stay on track when we begin to drift. However, the more mature we become in Christ, the easier it is actually to move away from community because we don't feel like we need the community as much as we once did. There's two critical errors to drifting away as we mature in Christ more and more. The first one is that we are never so mature that we don't need someone investing into us. We've covered this a little bit earlier, and I don't want to belabor it, but if Jesus surrounded himself with community, then certainly it's important for us to surround ourselves with community. We aren't so spiritually mature and we've got everything figured out that we can totally do it on our own. We need to surround ourselves with a community. The second error in this thinking is believing that community is just for your benefit. As you mature in your faith, it's your responsibility to stay in community for those who need your spiritual advice and leadership and guidance, just like you needed someone else's spiritual advice and leadership and guidance when you were new to the faith. We have to remember that at one time, we needed a more mature follower to lead us in the things of God. And as we mature, we should be that example for others. Five, and finally this morning, consistency is key to effective community. Consistency is key to effective community. Wives, if your husband only came home half the nights, that would not be effective community. You should shake your head so he knows that's true. In fact, I would say if your husband only came home 75% of the nights, that would not lead to effective community. I would go further and say that if he's supposed to be there, I mean, like if he's not off working or something, and he only came home 9 out of every 10 nights, that would not lead, that's not approved. Some of you ladies are like, man, I wish my husband would leave me alone half the time. I see it right over there. Okay, so let's rewind that. If you want your husband to be there, and he's not there, if he only shows up 90% of the time, I mean, once out of every 10 days, once every week and a half, your husband leaves and you don't know where he is, it's not going to lead to an effective community. Why? Because consistency is absolutely key to effective community. And we have people who attend churches today. I'm not talking about you because you guys are, I mean, right there on it. But there are people, believe it or not, who are attending churches today and they show up half the time, but they wonder why they don't feel connected to the community. 75% of the time they come and they wonder why I don't feel this deep connection. It's because consistency is key if you want to be connected. How consistent were the apostles? How consistent were the original disciples in staying connected to this community that Jesus had given them? We read about it in Acts chapter number 2, 42 through 47. And they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to fellowship, to the breaking of bread, into prayer. And all came upon every soul, and many signs and wonders were being done through the apostles, and all who believed together. And they had all things in common, and they were selling their possessions and belongings and distributing to all as any had need. And day by day, that means every day, and day by day, attending the temple together and breaking bread in their homes, they received their food with glad and generous hearts, praising God and having favor with all the people. And the Lord added to their number day by day those who were being saved. We see this phrase in there, day by day, twice. We should recognize what those two things are describing. Day by day, they connected with God and they connected with each other. Day by day, they went to the temple, and day by day, they ate in each other's homes and broke bread together. Day by day, they were invested in community with God and community with each other. The other time day by day is used is day by day, God was adding to their number those who were being saved. It's almost like those things are connected. Like their community with God and their community with each other was so attractive when people saw them living that out day after day after day after day, not out of obligation, but out of love. They wanted to be with God and they wanted to be with each other. And day by day, that's how they lived their life. And so day by day, God added to their number. Why? Because they were connected in community very, very consistently. Acts 2 gives us this amazing description of the New Testament church. They were devoted to learning. They shared their material possessions. They took care of the needy. And day by day, they enjoyed community. They weren't just halfway connected to community. They were fully invested in doing their life with a community of believers. And what God was doing was rewarding their devotion to Him and to each other. Can we be serious with each other today? Do like this. You are as connected as you want to be. You're as connected as you want to be to God. He's not hiding from you. How terrible would that be? To be chasing after a God who didn't want to be found. It's not the nature of God. In fact, you could think of a lot of scriptures that actually would take it the complete opposite way. That while we're still a long way off from God, all we have to do is make one step back to Him, just a turn back to Him. Like the prodigal son. And what did the father do? While he was still a long way off, rehearsing his speech and trying to work his way back in, what did the father do? The father ran to him, embraced him, loved him. You're as connected to God as you want to be. You're also as connected to a spiritual community as you want to be. You're as connected to church as you want to be. If you do not feel connected, it's because you're choosing to stay disconnected. Because we're here and we're reaching out. And we're going to do everything that we can do, continue to do everything we can do to foster healthy community and to build a place where people can find genuine relationship with God and genuine relationships with each other, and where those relationships can be born and can be fostered and can grow and can be healthy. You can find community here if you want it. but it's going to take a consistent connection. It's vital. Consistency is vital to our growth in Jesus Christ, to this process of discipleship. Consistency is critical to that. And that means faithful attendance to church. It means connecting with a small group or a Sunday school class within the church. It means a personal connection with a few close friends who are walking the same discipleship journey that you're walking. Again, we can be friendly to everyone, and we can have friends. But the people who are all the way on the inside, I mean the most core people in the life of a follower of Jesus, the most core people have to be other followers of Jesus. It just doesn't work. If you're trying to follow Jesus and you have people who are consistently speaking into your life from the point of view who are not trying to follow Jesus and who are not concerned with the kingdom of God and eternity, but are concerned with their kingdoms in the here and now, it won't work. You'll be torn. It's like a divided house. Eventually that house is going to fall. Eventually that house is going to crumble. So friendly to everyone, friends with many, but the most core people should be other brothers and sisters in Christ who you are speaking into because they need you, and who you're allowing to speak into you because you need them, and you're all better off when you're together. Everything's better in teams. So I want to encourage you this morning as we're getting ready to close. Don't try to walk this spiritual journey alone. Don't try to figure it all out for yourself. When you celebrate, there are people here who will celebrate with you. I know that there are places you can go in the world where you can't celebrate with people. Because somehow they see your success as their failure. And so they can't be happy for you. Not so here. You can find people here who you can celebrate with, who will be genuinely happy when you have success and when you advance and when you succeed. You can find that here. Maybe even more important than that, though, you can find people here who will stand with you, because there will be plenty of people in the world who will stand with you when there are things to celebrate. But you can find people here who will stand with you when there's nothing to celebrate. When there's nothing but worry and anxiety and fear and turmoil all around. You can find people here who will still stand with you and believe with you and pray with you. And they'll make the bad times easier, because you're all sharing the burden. You're doing it all together. So find your community, find your people, find your core. And then we go on this spiritual journey, this lifelong journey of following Jesus. We go on that together. Connecting with other people in community. What an awesome part of discipleship. There are some weeks where, like, it's a tough message. We read the Bible, and not everything in the Bible is always fun to read about. Not everything in the Bible is always fun to talk about. Certainly not everything in the Word of God is exciting or fun to implement in our lives. But this is a good one. It's good for you to have community. I'm glad that God put community in here. I'm glad that God established us as people who want, need, desire to have community. So find your community and walk out your spiritual life. It's a part of your discipleship process. You're not meant to do it alone. We're meant to be together. Amen. I'm thankful this morning I want you to hear my heart. I'm thankful this morning that you are on my team. And I'm thankful that I'm on your team. Thank God for bringing us together so that we can do life in community together. Amen. You guys stand with me this morning.